Hello, I'm Mishka, and this channel is the Helsinki Renaissance, where we will be talking about arts and culture in hopefully some kind of a manner. I don't even know what kind of an adjective take for this episode. We will be talking about Mika Kaurismäki movies, and perhaps a slight sense of almost being lost-ish is not entirely unfitting when it comes to Mika Kaurismäki's career, because I think on several different levels, being lost is something that goes very well with Mika Kaurismäki movies, because a fair amount of the protagonists in Mika Kaurismäki movies might on some level be described as being lost. And then on another level, compared to just how internationally renowned Aki Kaurismäki is, Mika Kaurismäki is completely lost in comparison when it comes to having made that kind of a top tier director career globally. And then thirdly, because there's such a huge disparity between the first half of Mika Kaurismäki's career and the second half of Mika Kaurismäki's career. So, perhaps arguably, even some Mika Kaurismäki movies, it might feel like they are lost on some level, especially those late films. Just all in all, like a slight sense of being lost is not necessarily us not being where we shouldn't be when we are talking about Mika Kaurismäki movies. Now, in an earlier video, I said that I did a two-part video on Aki Kaurismäki movies. The first video about Aki Kaurismäki's position in the Finnish filmmaking landscape, and the second video about my giving my overall thoughts about Aki Kaurismäki movies one by one. But I decided that the video where I went over my opinions on Kaurismäki movies, I decided that that was unnecessary. So I ended up not keeping that. I'm not publishing it because, I just thought that it doesn't matter. But anyway, I think that because the kind of international art house fans or film fans, they are already familiar enough with Aki Kaurismäki, in that it's just, there's a case that a couple of the early period movies are too obscure and people don't know about them because the films haven't been made available for them. But all in all, I think that Aki Kaurismäki movies, they don't need introductions to them in the way that Mika Kaurismäki movies might. So even though I didn't, the Aki Kaurismäki sort of that overview, I deemed it unnecessary, but I think that this has quite a bit of potential value for some people, because if the international careers are anything to go by, people assume that Aki Kaurismäki is some sort of a master auteur, and then that Mika Kaurismäki is some sort of a second-rate journeyman. But I don't think that that's at all the case. With Valentin Vaala and Teuvo Tulio, Teuvo Tulio is treated as, leagues better a director than Valentin Vaala. But I don't think that that's such an open and shut case that Tulio is better. I think that Valentin Vaala, there are portions of his filmography where he can, more than hold his own. And I think that Mika Kaurismäki has a similar thing in that some people who just haven't seen enough films from all four directors, they might think that it goes without saying that Aki Kaurismäki is way better a director than Mika Kaurismäki, whereas even though, yes, I think that Aki Kaurismäki, his filmography is superior, but I don't think that there's such a wild disparity as what some people seem to act. But I think that what's making the Aki Kaurismäki-Mika Kaurismäki comparison the most interesting is that this is potentially a slightly controversial claim from me, but I actually think that the first half of Aki Kaurismäki's filmography is rather bad. So if in Mika Kaurismäki's filmography, the logical central point is, I would say that Highway Society in 2000, like that's the movie that there's Mika Kaurismäki's career before Highway Society and after Highway Society. And I think that everyone can agree that the pre-Highway Society filmography is way better than the post-Highway Society filmography. And then likewise with Aki Kaurismäki, I don't see lots of people agreeing with me, but I'm making this case that the pre La Vie de Bohème filmography from Aki Kaurismäki, it's rather weak in comparison to post La Vie de Bohème filmography. And that there's a great deal of randomness in the pre-La Vie de Bohème Aki Kaurismäki. And that for me, films like Hamlet Goes Business and Leningrad Cowboys Meet Moses, to me, those are kind of misfires. Then there's lots of projects like I Hired a Contract Killer that, just couldn't live up to its potential, and so on. So even though Aki Kaurismäki has some films that I rate very highly in the pre-La Vie de Bohème, I still say that Kaurismäki only reaches his prime from the movies from La Vie de Bohème onwards. So to me and to lots of Finnish film critics, the kind of Far Away the Clouds and The Man Without a Past, those types of movies are basically the mainline in Kaurismäki, and then the kind of quirky, sometimes half-baked early works are more like interesting curios. But it's interesting to note that with Aki Kaurismäki and Mika Kaurismäki, their primes are the opposite. So with Mika, his first films are his best films, and with Aki, I'd argue that his last films are his best films. I don't see other people have a similar take on Aki Kaurismäki, that sometimes the pre-La Vie de Bohème movies like Ariel and Shadows in Paradise and Match Factory Girl, sometimes they can get, some people think that those are coming from a leading position, but as I said, even though I think that there are occasional strong films in the pre-La Vie de Bohème Aki Kaurismäki filmography, I think that I think that his main mode was basically there was something missing from his movies. And I would say that with Mika Kaurismäki, his post-Highway Society movie, there's just a certain something missing from those movies. And, what I associate with the Mika Kaurismäki legacy, it's all about the pre-Highway Society. And what I associate as the Aki Kaurismäki legacy, it's all about the post-La Vie de Bohème. So that's just my reading of it and how their sort of prime years of their careers happen. I am basically daring to say that the Mika Kaurismäki prime career, it matches up respectably well with the Aki Kaurismäki prime, in that, you know, it's the lesser half of Mika Kaurismäki's filmography that cannot hope to compete with the lesser half of Aki Kaurismäki's filmography. But I'd say that as far as the you know, best filmmaking years from Mika, I think that he's still sort of, he's still like hanging in there as like, an auteur director that, has something interesting about him. But, and, you know, lots of people probably won't agree with me, but if I said that the earliest of Aki Kaurismäki, the pre-La Vie de Bohème, if I said that that's his weak period, lots of people would still rate Aki's weak period better than Mika's prime period, but I don't. I actually think that Mika Kaurismäki's first films are better than Aki Kaurismäki's first films, and you know, if enough international audiences would just start watching the early Mika Kaurismäki films, I think that they could start rating them more highly than some of the Aki Kaurismäki films like Match Factory Girl or Hamlet Goes Business. But obviously, you know, that's all a matter of individual tastes, and I was just putting out where I'm coming from. Anyway, like, it's also interesting not comparing Aki and Mika Kaurismäki, but also to compare Aki Kaurismäki to Robert Bresson. Because, like, Robert Bresson in his early years, he was making these almost ecumenical movies. Like, there was grace and sweetness in his main approach, with the kind of scheme in some films like Les Dames du Bois de Bologna or Diary of a Country Priest or A Man Escaped, that there's a certain kind of overall narrative of grace about early Bresson. But then the more Bresson's career went on, the less graceful his film become. Lancelot of the Lake is the exception. But anyway, like, other than that, you know, films like Mouchette, Balthazar, The Devil Probably, L'Argent, like those late period Bresson films, they just get, harder and harder. And, you know, with Aki Kaurismäki, it's the opposite. So if Bresson started sweet and became harder, Aki Kaurismäki started hard with films like Crime and Punishment and Match Factory Girl. But then he gets progressively, like, slightly more ecumenical towards the end years as towards the films like Far Away the Clouds, Man Without a Past, Le Havre, and so on. So it's just like, I don't want to talk about the Kaurismäki films more, but the Aki Kaurismäki films. But I just wanted to put that out there as like something for viewers to maybe appreciate a bit. But anyway, like, we should jump into talking about this Mika Kaurismäki movies. The thing about Mika Kaurismäki that no one seems to give him proper credit for is that I think it's entirely realistic to suppose that Aki Kaurismäki would have never become a film director if his older brother hadn't gone into a film school in Germany, and then Mika Kaurismäki became an independent director in Finland, and here is a young Aki Kaurismäki. Mika was taking Aki on as an actor, and I don't know if Aki was also co-writing some of the films, But Aki Kaurismäki got his start in filmmaking through Mika Kaurismäki's early work. So here's two short films on this DVD. A film called Valehtelija from 1981 and Jackpot 2 from 1982. I think that the Jackpot movie is a minor work that's barely interesting enough to be a DVD extra. So I won't talk about that. But The Liar, which is the headliner here, it's a not entirely satisfying experience, but it's something that's like coming from a place of, it's coming from a place of great potential. I think that The Liar reminded me a lot of some of the French New Wave directors' short films that they started their career on. So like some stuff like All the Boys Are Called Patrick, or Truffaut's Lemiston, or Rivette's Fool's Mate. Like, I think this is like that, except like this is twice as long. So the script in The Liar is not very good. The acting I like, and the kind of early Antonioni-esque direction. I'd say that it's all shaping up to making The Liar into, like this kind of like a minor winning moment in both Aki Kaurismäki and Mika Kaurismäki's career. I think that The Liar is showing that they were about to start making really good movies, both of them. I basically like The Liar. Lots of people in Finland don't seem to know that The Liar has a sequel directed by a director called Anssi Mänttäri did a film called Viimeiset rotannahat. I have no idea what the English translation or well, the international English title is, but The Last Ratskins is the literal translation, and Aki Kaurismäki, he returns as the Ville Alpha character. And the main character in The Last Ratskins is supposedly his father, who is e an even bigger scapegrace than he is. I'd say that The Last Ratskins, it's less good of a movie than this, but it's maybe an interesting curio for some people to track down. I don't know whether to recommend it or not. But anyway, like, The Liar, I think, has just enough charm about it for me to basically recommend it. I think it's a rather encouraging a beginning for two careers. The next film that Mika Kaurismäki has is called The Worthless, Arvottomat, and this is, like, ever since I first saw it, this has been my favorite Finnish movie of all time. And I'm pretty sure that this could make my top 10 movies of all time, from all countries. Like, I'm a huge fan of this. And, this is Mika Kaurismäki's feature-length debut. That I think that the success of this movie, it wasn't necessarily a similar kind of juggernaut that Pulp Fiction was when Quentin Tarantino came onto the scene, but like the way that some of the 90s American indie directors, when they started breaking onto the mainstream, like when Aki and Mika Kaurismäki broke onto the mainstream with this film, like, that was like a slightly comparable event. Now, this is a road movie, But basically, to me, like half of the charm of this movie, well, beside the cast, like half of the charm of this movie, I think is that it's basically like this kind of postmodern neo-noir. So, like, this has maybe like this is somewhere between like the French New Wave and then the cinema du look that people like Luc Besson and Benier were doing in 80s France. So like this is somewhere lost in between French New Wave style and cinema du look style. But anyway, like basically as a postmodern neo-noir, this has a lot of charm for me. And then this has the kind of novelistic scope to it. That, I mean, like, the way that some people can quote every line from the Big Lebowski, that they like every moment from the Big Lebowski, I feel that way towards this movie. Like, ever since I first saw it, it was my favorite Finnish movie. And Aki Kaurismäki, he returns as the Ville Alpha character in this movie, but like I don't think that there's much of a continuum with that character in that this is the like the way that in Yasujirō Ozu the character is called Noriko in three different films, but it's not the same character. I think that Ville Alpha returning in different films, I think that that's like there's something like that going on. But anyway, like lots of people like Arvottomat when it came out, but I probably like it way more because like it's like from both Aki and Mika Kaurismäki's career, it's my favorite film of from either. Now the follow-up that Mika had to The Worthless is a film called Klaani. Tales of the Clan of the Frogs. That title is, shall we say, bizarre. And I think that the strangeness of the title, that there's a clan of the frogs, like what the like apparently there's a family that has frog as its surname or sammakko in Finnish. I have no idea why, but like I think that the strangeness of the title reflects the position that this movie has in the Mika Kaurismäki filmography, in that safe to say that no Mika Kaurismäki movie could ever be as highly anticipated as the follow-up to Worthless. And when I first saw this movie, I was disappointed, but now that I rewatched it again for this video, I actually like this so much so that I think that you'd be hard-pressed to leave this out of your top 5 Mika Kaurismäki films. Like, when I watched the Mika Kaurismäki interview for this Klaani film, he talked about how he fell in love with the source novel, in that he thought that there was something slightly Dostoyevskian about it. He thought that it would make a great movie with an ensemble cast that you try to give everyone sort of formidable roles. And as far as the casting goes, this is probably the most impressive Mika Kaurismäki movie. So that Lasse Pöysti, who's something like a legend in the Finnish film industry, Lasse Pöysti potentially gives his greatest performance in here. Matti Pellonpään Esko Nikkari and Kari Väänänen, those are, all-time great actors. This has a lot of quality to it, but I think unfortunately the main character, who, like, I wonder if he was an amateur, like, he was somebody with no acting experience before this. I think that the main character is the weakest performance, and I think that the film slightly collapses because, like, the main character cannot support it. So, like, if, I mean, this is a bit of a stretch, but, you know, if this had a Marlon Brando or Montgomery Clift or even Alain Delon level main actor, I think that we'd be talking about, you know, one of the epic classics of European cinema. But the main character slightly sinks the movie, but, you know, like, the acting, other than that, is great throughout, and I was sort of reminded of late period Melville movies with this. So some films like The Red Circle or Anne Flick, like, you know, if there are fans of late Melville, you know, this might be a bit of a hidden gem with the Mika Kaurismäki filmography. I think that the cinematography is jaw-dropping at times. Like, there genuinely is, like, a bit of an all-star cast and crew to the Klaani movie. It's not perfect film, but, I would certainly recommend as many people to give it a try as can find it, because, you know, there's certainly some kind of quality to it. And I don't think the Dostoevsky comparisons with the source novel, I don't think they're completely out of place. It's just that, the film is very blunt in everything it does. And, a certain degree of nuance could have perhaps served it well, or served it better, but it's certainly a film that has lots of things going for it. A film that's sort of, you know, reinforcing the quality in early Kaurismäki for me. Then the film that Mika Kaurismäki did after that is a film called Rosso. Now, this is a film that I assumed would be my second favorite Mika Kaurismäki movie. But upon rewatching this, I have to say that this went slightly down in my estimations, because this is a film where some segments are shot in Italy and other segments are shot in Finland. I think that the segments shot in Italy are they are the ones that make this movie seem like a major work, and then the Finnish segments, they are, you know, step lower in quality, I think. You know, Mika Kaurismäki, he was saying how they didn't have any shooting permits for Italy, so this was like a bit of a guerrilla filmmaking. This was a really low budget filmmaking, and as far as, you know, having lemons and making lemonade type that project is concerned, this is a very successful film in that regard. But I think that the main hook to this movie is great. It has lots of things going for it, but unfortunately, when I was watching it, I was halfway really with the movie. But I also thought that it was maybe a case of close but no cigar, because of the great scarcity that, this is almost like shoestring budget filmmaking, even though, like, I believe it's shot on 35mm, and the cinematography is great throughout. If it has Timo Salminen, and it does, I think that lots of people have reasons to think that Timo Salminen is the greatest cinematographer in Finnish cinema. You know, certainly some of the earlier cinematographers, like Esko Töyri or something, could, like, bring competition, but Timo Salminen is a top-line talent, and he's there in some of the early Mika Kaurismäki movies, and he's making sure that a certain level of quality is going to be there. But, you know, with Rosso, I still recommend the movie, but I thought that it started to show its limitations now that I rewatched it. So I don't know where I'd rank it. Would it be a top 5? Definitely a top 10 film, but I don't know. I don't know. Like, I'd say that it's 2/3 of a brilliant movie, and then it has some slightly lackluster moments, but I would basically recommend it. Anyway, if Rosso was almost like a, faux international movie, in that there was a Finnish actor playing an Italian character, and some really quick shoots in Italy. Helsinki, Napoli All Night Long, which is Mika Kaurismäki's follow-up to Rosso. Helsinki, Napoli All Night Long is a true international project. It's shot in Berlin, which is like the reason that the film is called Helsinki, Napoli All Night Long is because Berlin is in the halfway point of Helsinki and Napoli. There's a Finnish man and an Italian woman who are married together living in Berlin. He's a taxi driver, and there's a crime film subplot where Samuel Fuller plays some sort of a crime boss who there's some sort of a MacGuffin that different groups of criminals are chasing. Helsinki, Napoli All Night Long, it has the Samuel Fuller cameo isn't the only one. It also has a Wim Wenders cameo and Jim Jarmusch cameo. It has some leading international actors such as Nino Manfredi and Eddie Constantine. Oh my God. Yeah, so this has Nino Manfredi and Eddie Constantine. I think that the kind of like this has a proper international production about it. I'd say that this is like almost a major success. Like the reason why I'm like slightly lowering my praise is that as far as like as far as like this kind of feel good comedy, like crime comedy, a really tongue-in-cheek. I don't know if you'd call this a really tongue-in-cheek neo-noir. I don't know how to classify it, but like I think that basically it has a lot of things going for it, but there's like just the slightest sloppiness of production. And again, they had certain kind of limitations shooting in Berlin. They really had to get creative about how they were gonna get everything that they wanted. But I basically put this in my top 5 Mika Kaurismäki films, I guess. And the international additions, I think, are the ones that really make this movie. Kari Väänänen, the way he speaks English might require subtitles for some people, but I personally greatly like Väänänen as an actor. Like lots of people in Finland like him as an actor. I think that Helsinki, Napoli All Night Long, like the script is sort of the script is, I guess, good enough. The direction, I guess, good enough, and then the cast is what makes it special if it is to be special. But I would recommend Helsinki, Napoli All Night Long. I think it could be the kind of like if there are fans of like early Jim Jarmusch, that there's an indie film with the kind of crime comedy type vibe to it, like I think that Helsinki, Napoli All Night Long could maybe play to fans of early Jarmusch. Then follow up to that, there's a TV movie that I haven't seen, so I can talk about that, and I don't even want to talk about it to be honest. Not in much of a rush to see it. But anyway, then the next Mika Kaurismäki film is this you'd almost have to call this like a Trading Places rip-off. You know, if you've seen the John Landis movie Trading Places, you know, here is a hobo living under the bridge who gets a taste of the high life to basically, you know, earn, like, he basically just has to jump through hoops to earn his inheritance. The script is a bit silly. But I think that the cast to this movie is basically what makes it into something that might be enduring. And if I complain that Rosso and Helsinki, Napoli are not long, if I think that they had a bit of sloppiness to them as far as the direction was concerned, that really prevented them from being the kind of huge classics that they maybe could have. In the best case scenario, could have been. I think that Cha-Cha-Cha is the Mika Kaurismäki movie that this has the greatest potential that it just couldn't quite meet. You know, if I said that Rosso was two-thirds of a great movie, I think that this is like half of a great movie. Like some of the, like Matti Pellonpää. You know, if I said that if Klaani only had a Montgomery Clift or Alain Delon type actor in the lead, like this has a lead character who makes every moment that he's part of. Matti Pellonpää is that kind of a, you know, major actor who elevates everything that he touches in here. But then something about the movie around Matti Pellonpää, it's just I think that there's lots of moments where they were setting the bar really low for themselves, and this could have been something really special, but unfortunately I don't know if I can recommend it to viewers. I think that let's see if it also had Timo Salminen. Yes, of course, it looked like a Timo Salminen Salminen movie, so in other words, it looks stunning from a certain standpoint, like not the kind of in-your-face type cinematography that you know some other leading international figures might, but like Timo Salminen, he won't let any production down. So you know, Cha-Cha-Cha, it had certain things going for it. But I basically I don't know if I can recommend it. Like I said that some people might give it a try. Like perhaps some people can have a good time with it. But like it's very evidently a film that was made solely because Mika Kaurismäki wanted to work with Matti Pellonpää again. So it's a project that's very much built around Matti Pellonpää, and very evidently the non-Matti Pellonpää related elements in the film, they just aren't particularly strong. So Cha-Cha-Cha, it has certain kind of charm to it, but yeah, I don't know if I can recommend it. But anyway, the last film of the 80s that Mika Kaurismäki has, released in the same years as Cha-Cha-Cha in 1989, is a film called Paperitähti or Paper Star. Paper Star, it's a somewhat strange, like, I don't know this for a fact, but Peter Bogdanovich has a film called Paper Moon, and the Paper Moon is sort of, you know, flirting with disillusionment. I think that the Paper Star is meant to work in that kind of register. But anyway, like Paper Moon has something of the masterpiece about it. in my books, and you know, potentially Bogdanovich's best movie, I might say. Paper Star certainly is nowhere near Mika Kaurismäki's best movie, but again, Timo Salminen as cinematographer, you know, he's doing his bit to give this a chance to being good. I think that Pirkko Hämäläinen, who was the female lead in Arvottomat, she's good in this, but you know, I think that this is a film that tries to play a bit like John Schlesinger's Darling, or something. But I don't think this is a good project at all. You know, there's a scene where the Pirkko Hämäläinen character, she, I don't know if it's a dream sequence where she's giving an interview, where she's, you know, answering everything about her, and she gives the kind of truth in the answers. But like, to me, that sequence seems to represent what's problematic with the script, in that, you know, like, the film is extremely sympathetic to the woman who is basically being exploited, both professionally and then in her private relationships. Like, the film is very sympathetic to her and, you know, wants to paint her in the best light. But it's just, like, the kind of, you know, unequivocal desire to do right by her, I think just makes the overall film kind of two-dimensional, in that she's like some sort of a little Red Riding Hood, you know, in Wolf Town, trying to get out or something. Like, some of the end scenes shot in Stockholm, they were kind of good. This has a couple of good set pieces, very influenced by Antonin's Blow Up. But overall, I'd say that that, like, you know, I don't think it's a very successful movie. I think that the screenplay is basically, you know, just not good enough, and it just doesn't really work. But anyway, the next film that Mika Kaurismäki has is a film called Amazon. Kari Väänänen in the lead, Robert Davi in co-lead. It's Mika Kaurismäki's perhaps his biggest international production at that point. So a Finnish family goes into the Amazon rainforest, and then there's like a fish out of water, you know, comedy drama made about it. I basically like Amazon more than most people do, but you know, the thing is that if some of the films Mika Kaurismäki had made pre-Amazon, I'd say that Cha-Cha-Cha is maybe like the only mainstream movie, and Cha-Cha-Cha is probably the only mainstream movie, and the others maybe are sort of awkwardly caught between the art house and the multiplex. So, you know, Amazon is Mika Kaurismäki certainly sort of getting closer to the mainstream. There's nothing art housey about Amazon. It's not something like Peter Weir's Mosquito Coast, which is a slightly more uncompromising a tale. You know, like, if Werner Herzog's Aguirre is here, Mosquito Coast here, Amazon would be here, if you can appreciate that kind of grouping, in that I think For the general viewer, Amazon is out of those three movies the one that makes itself the most accessible. And I understand that some art house fans don't like it, that it sort of like makes itself approachable, but you know, like I think that Amazon, like Mika Kaurismäki, he seems to have a good rapport with Brazil, and I just think Amazon is a really successful movie. I liked it. But, you know, lots of people are treating it as a minor work, but I just, you know, I had a good time watching that movie. So I don't know if I'd recommend it to, like, international audiences, but, you know, like, I'm just saying that I liked it. Then what on some level is the last feature film of Mika Kaurismäki's, like, peak period is a film called Zombie and the Ghost Train. Zombie and the Ghost Train, you know, I think that this has some obvious comparisons that it makes with the Leningrad Cowboys movies. So Aki Kaurismäki has Leningrad Cowboys as like a family, and they are in an absurdist comedy, but the strength in that movie is that the family are, you know, they are giving something to each other, giving some sort of a place of belonging. But this Zombie and the Ghost Train movie is, if one of the Leningrad Cowboys was an orphan without a family and just wandering the world like a lonely ghost. I think that, you know, the way that Leningrad Cowboys is a really warm comedy and Zombie and the Ghost Train is a rather bleak drama about alienation. I think that they have some interesting rapport with each other. And another link that the two films have is that the Matti Pellonpää character, he plays a music manager in both movies, and a music manager that dresses like a cowboy, you know, to boot. But the difference is that in Aki Kaurismäki, the Matti Pellonpää character, it's like some sort of a, you know, Brechtian satire on capitalism. So like, the manager is basically like the enemy of the band, and Kaurismäki wrote it to basically denounce such forces in society. So, you know, Aki Kaurismäki, he also has like, he also almost has like some sort of a, you know, didactic socialist bent to his writing. And with Mika Kaurismäki, you know, I think Mika Kaurismäki, I've said before in videos that if Aki Kaurismäki is Mika's brother, it feels like Wim Wenders is Mika's true cinematic twin, in that they both make road movies and they both have lots of documentaries in their filmography. And with both of them, the early work is the strongest and the late work is the weakest. I think that Mika Kaurismäki and Wim Wenders, and the two of them are friends and so on. But like their careers have a lot of going for them. But I think that Jean Renoir is another connection to make with Mika Kaurismäki. So the way that Jean Renoir had this, you know, philosophy that everyone has their reasons, and you know, they are like trying to give every character their due, and you know, represent the humanity in everyone. So the way that Aki Kaurismäki just had a Brechtian denouncement of a manager in Leningrad Cowboys Go America, how Mika Kaurismäki differs from Aki is that if you contrast the Matti Pellonpää manager in this movie, like there's a great humanism to the manager, you know, like the manager Matti Pellonpää, he's like constantly, he's an outstretched arm trying to help Zombie in every way throughout the movie, but you know, the Zombie character in this, you know, he is a lost soul, and the movie just cannot be about him being saved because it's about somebody being lost. But anyway, like, you know, the kind of Jean Renoir type level to Mika Kaurismäki's writing and filmmaking, it's just sort of, you know, that isn't really there like that in Aki Kaurismäki, but in Mika Kaurismäki, I'd say that it's one of the defining things about his filmmaking. Anyway, then the film that Mika Kaurismäki did, wait, sorry, there's this kind of, you know, if Cha-Cha-Cha was like a rip-off of Trading Places, The Last Border is like a really cheap rip-off of Mad Max series. But anyway, The Last Border is a flop, and, you know, Mika Kaurismäki in this period, he has The Last Border and Conditioned Red as like Renny Harlin level flops in his middle period. And I think that, you know, how those films flopped may have played some kind of a role in Mika becoming very documentary heavy later on, and basically starting to resemble a journeyman director later on. So I don't really know how much to say, like, The Last Border and Condition Red, they are movies that I've never heard anyone say anything positive about them, you know, they were huge flops, like arguably bigger flops than what Renny Harlin has had, not from a monetary standpoint, but from the kind of, you know, rejection standpoint. But anyway, the next movie that I wanted to talk about was Mika Kaurismäki having a documentary, basically, you know, starring Jim Chalmers and Samuel Fuller, going, like, they are in Brazil. Samuel Fuller is just talking about a certain moment in time in his career. And, you know, Mika Kaurismäki, he said that he considered Samuel Fuller basically like a family member, that they just couldn't have been closer. Both Aki and Mika Kaurismäki, they basically idolized Fuller. And, you know, Fuller is there in bit parts throughout Aki Kaurismäki's and Mika Kaurismäki's movies. You know, in La Vida Bohème, Fuller, for instance, has a cameo. In Helsinki, Napoli, All Night Long, Fuller has a cameo. And here's a 74-minute documentary. You know, I would recommend it to anyone even remotely interested in these kinds of, you know, this kind of cinematic-type directors like Samuel Fuller. Like, I think Tigrero, you know, it has something beautiful about it. And then I'm gonna skip over a bunch of documentaries and short films. And I'm not gonna comment on Highway Society because I haven't seen it in such a long time. But I think that that's the most Wim Wenders-ish film that Mika Kaurismäki has. It's like some sort of a road movie. I don't know. I don't want to talk about it. I remember it being a minor work. But anyway, what I think as a hidden gem, and probably the last hidden gem that Mika Kaurismäki has, is a film called Alley Without a Map. I was so happy when I saw a list of 90s indie films that somebody recommended, and I saw Alley Without a Map there. It just made me so happy that somebody was recognizing that there's a lot of quality in that film. Because, you know, Alley Without a Map, it has a Johnny Depp cameo that came about through the Jim Chalmers connection. Jim Chalmers, friends with Mika Kaurismäki, and had directed Johnny Depp in The Dead Man. You know, Johnny Depp has a cameo in LA Without the Map. David Tennant is there. Julie Delpy, I think, is there. Vinesha Shaw is there. The kind of, you know, I'd say that LA Without the Map, tonally, it gets closest to Amazon. So it's basically a mainstream movie. It's made really approachable, but it's just getting slightly lost in the flood. But I definitely recommend it to lots of people. To me, it's like the hidden gem in the Mika Kaurismäki film. I don't know why it's so difficult getting it on DVD. Is there some like release rights snafu? I don't know. But like, if anyone can watch it, it's a mainstream film, but I'd recommend it. Then there's a bunch of documentaries that I don't feel like talking about it. I'd say that they have a comparable presence that that Wim Wenders' documentaries have in his filmography. That they're the kind of curios in there. I'd almost want to say for completists only, you know, if somebody wants to watch a Miriam Makembe documentary or a documentary of Brazilian music, Mika Kaurismäki has lots of those, you know, some documentaries about Finnish personalities that he's either directed or produced. There's some stuff like that in the, to me, that Three Wise Men movie, I thought that it was basically like a rather discouraging flop. I remember when it came out, like it was a film shot in 3 days, just improvised, and you know, it didn't really connect. The Haarautuva rakkauden talo, is it something like divorce Finnish style? Like, I don't think at all successful. You know, Mika Kaurismäki, he had 3 movies that he made with Vesa-Matti Loiri. You know, if Cha-Cha-Cha was built around Mika Kaurismäki being able to work with Matti Pellonpää once again, those Elämältä kaiken säännön Tie pohjoiseen movies, they are evidently built around Mika Kaurismäki being able to collaborate with Vesa-Matti Loiri. And I said that in those 2 movies, The Road to North and whatever Elämältä kaiken sain is in English, Vesa-Matti Loiri is good in both movies, but I think that, again, like with Cha-Cha-Cha, the film around them isn't something that I can really recommend. But anyway, I thought that The Road to North was basically like a good movie. I think that probably the best road movie that Mika has in like a couple of decades. Like, The Road to North was just good enough. Elämältä kaiken sain, I thought, a bit disappointing. Like, the Loiri, like, Elämältä kaiken sain, maybe was a bit like Cha-Cha-Cha, in that perhaps this was like a half of a good movie, some rather sketchy moments of writing, but like the sloppy half really drags it down. So I don't know if I can recommend it. And then the last movie that Mika Kaurismäki has done, this really international work called Tyttö Kuningas, The Girl King, about Queen Christina of Sweden. You know, this is something that I'd compare to Sofia Coppola's Maria Antoinette, in that it's this... well, you know, if I thought that this paper star... if I thought that this paper star movie had some deficiencies on the script level, this Girl King movie is like the version of the paper star, where the, you know, the girl at the center thinks of herself as some sort of a Renaissance genius. So, you know, I'd say that the script of the Girl King is completely preposterous, but like, I mean, Mika Nyqvist gives a great performance. Some of the cast, some of the cinematography, like, there's like some kind of quality in there. But again, like with lots of late period films from Mika, it's at the best of times a case of close but no cigar. But anyway, I have to wrap things up now. And I thank you for watching. And bye-bye.